This is part 3 of a 3-part video essay on progestins in hormonal contraceptives. In part 1, I went over progestins classification and steroid hormone receptor activity patterns. Part 2 covered combined oral contraceptive pills, and this part 3 covers progestin-only pills, the evolution of the oral contraceptives, and their adverse and beneficial side effects. So in the previous video, I went over the combined oral contraceptive pills, so I recommend you go watch that if you didn't watch it. So now I'm going to go into the progestin-only contraceptive pills, and then after that, do a summary of the two types of contraceptive pills side by side. So moving on to progestogen-only contraception, or specifically the oral contraceptive pills, progestin-only pills are used much less than COCs. In the evolution of oral contraceptives, the COCs came first. Then it was discovered that progestins alone were enough for the contraceptive effect. Actually, the early progestins were not able to consistently inhibit ovulation, so their main mechanism was thickening of cervical mucus and thinning of the endometrium. But actually, estrogen has anti-follicular activity and covers the inhibiting of the ovulation, so that way enhances the contraceptive effect of progestins. And then later on, desogestrel was found to be able to consistently inhibit ovulation as well, so I'll come back to this later. The first progestin-only pills were with norethisterone and levonorgestrel, but these were generally viewed as not as effective as the standard COCs, as they didn't inhibit ovulation. So they were generally only for breastfeeding women who were already naturally less fertile anyway. And also, estrogen is not recommended during breastfeeding because estrogen reduces breast milk. One annoying issue with the first generation progestin-only pill was that they needed to be taken at the same time every day with only a 2-hour missed pill window. However, this changed when the third generation progestin desogestrel came out as a POP. This was the first POP that could inhibit ovulation consistently. In addition, has a 12-hour missed pill window, making it much more user-friendly. Desogestrel is also the first POP available without prescription in the UK. However, it currently does not seem to be available in Hong Kong, presumably due to lack of demand, possibly due to the breakthrough bleeding issue commonly seen with POPs. The latest POP uses drospirenone. This only came out in 2020, and remarkably, not only has a 24-hour missed pill window, it also has a hormone-free interval incorporated into its regimen, so making it the first POP of its kind and the first POP that can be said to be comparable to a COC, but without an estrogen component in it. POPs are known for their nuisance unscheduled breakthrough bleeds, so the benefit here would be to be able to schedule the bleed with a 4-day hormone-free interval. However, it seems breakthrough bleeds have still been reported with drospirenone POP, so it remains to be seen how well it's received. So far, drospirenone POP is available in the US under the brand name of Slind. And I think in Australia it's called Slinder, but currently does not seem to be available in Hong Kong or the UK. This video is meant to be focusing on the oral contraceptive pill, but for context, you should know that many of the non-pill forms of hormonal contraception employ progestin-only formulations, such as the depot injection Depo-Provera, which uses medroxyprogesterone acetate, the intrauterine device Myrina, which uses levonorgestrel, and there is also an under-the-skin implant option available. For example, Nexplanon, which uses the progestin etonogestrel. Most of these will also be available as generic brands as well. The IUD progestin method is considered to be the most effective hormonal contraception in terms of preventing pregnancy, as once successfully placed in the uterus, it can last for up to 5 years and removes the human error factor, which often occurs with daily pill taking. There is also a copper IUD, which is also very effective and provides a non-hormonal option for women. However, it is associated with heavy menstrual bleeds. And there's also the emergency contraceptive pill, which is basically levonorgestrel. So to recap, with the COCs, which are the most commonly used method of hormonal contraception, the first generation COCs are not seen much. The second generation COC, specifically levonorgestrel COC, is very commonly seen because of its low VTE risk and low cost, but is associated with the androgenic effects of acne, hirsutism, and unfavorable lipid profile. The third generation COCs started using third generation progestins specifically designed to reduce the androgenic effects seen with levonorgestrel COC. And they succeeded, except now they had increased VTE risk. The fourth generation progestin drospirenone was arguably revolutionary in the progestin world, and to date is still the only progestin which is both anti-androgen and anti-mineralocorticoid. The anti-mineralocorticoid effect enabled it to be marketed as reducing bloating and water retention, a big complaint with a lot of women on the pill, but it still has the increased VTE risk, same as the third generation COCs, so it could be speculated that the androgen components counteracted the VTE effect of ethinyl estradiol. So up until 2010, the COCs were primarily using ethinyl estradiol, and the latest COCs started using alternative natural estrogens, that is estradiol and estetrol, to try and tackle the VTE issue. Whilst promising, however, they are more expensive, and the uptake has been on the low side, making it difficult to judge whether VTE risk has been lowered significantly. Plus, the latest one with drospirenone and estetrol has only just come out in 2021, so time will tell how well they do in the long run. And with the POPs, the early POPs were mostly just for breastfeeding women as they were less convenient to use compared to COCs and had breakthrough bleeding. And it wasn't until desogestrel POP came out that a POP started becoming a viable option for more women, especially those who wanted a non-estrogen option. And the latest POP using drospirenone is the most remarkable, with a 24-hour missed pill window and even a 4-day hormone-free interval, making it comparable to a COC. But a pharmacology video on COCs wouldn't be complete without going over their side effects, other than the ones I've already mentioned earlier, as well as their beneficial effects. The side effects can be divided into kind of more minor nuisance side effects and the more potentially serious health risks. I want to emphasize that the incidence of most of the adverse side effects are small, and the beneficial effects outweigh the risks of the adverse effects for most women. For side effects, I've already mentioned things like acne, hirsutism, and VTE. So I'm going to start off here with the CNS effects. The steroid hormones have CNS effects, and this applies to endogenous hormones as well as synthetic ones. Estrogen is CNS stimulating, and opposing this is progesterone, which is sedating. Progestogen is also associated with low mood, depression, and also may have something to do with low libido, which is often associated with the pill. Usually this is opposed by the estrogen component in COCs, but there may be a small risk of hormonal contraception causing depression in women who have a history of depression. Combined hormonal contraceptives are able to treat PMDD, which is a more severe form of PMS, as PMS is more to do with the surge of progesterone in the second half of the menstrual cycle, which CHCs are able to remove or level out. In fact, drospirenone, COC, also known by the brand name of Yasmin, also actually has a license for the management of PMDD. I mentioned weight gain before. It is a common complaint. Official UK sources say that there doesn't seem to be actual evidence to show that the pill actually does cause weight gain. But pharmacologically speaking, water retention could occur with COCs with estrogen, so this could be related to that. The COCs are associated with the risk of cardiovascular disease, so this is related to the progestin opposing the CBD, a protective effect of estrogen coupled with water retention and possible blood pressure increase. The risk is small, but increases with older women and women who smoke. In terms of cancer, COCs have both adverse effects and beneficial effects. They are associated with a small increased risk of breast cancer and cervical cancer. However, this needs to be taken into context as the risk due to COC is very small. For example, the risk of breast cancer associated with obesity and smoking is actually higher. Similarly, cervical cancer is more likely to be caused by the HPV virus than COC. Having said that, the risk will be higher in some women. For example, older women, smokers, obese women, and those with a genetic history of breast or cervical cancer. If that is the case, alternative methods should be considered. For example, non-hormonal contraception. In contrast, the protective effects of COCs against ovarian and endometrial cancer are remarkable. There are really not many drugs out there which can be said to prevent cancer. Unlike the evidence for breast and cervical cancer, which is conflicting, there is overwhelming evidence to show that COCs can reduce the risk of ovarian and endometrial cancer by a whopping 50% if you take them consistently for 10 years. And not only that, the protective effect persists for 10 to 30 years after cessation. And this protective effect would be very meaningful for someone who has a genetic predisposition for ovarian cancer, for example. I've also included colorectal cancer, although the risk reduction with colorectal cancer seems to be much smaller in comparison to ovarian and endometrial cancer. And finally, I want to end with the numerous non-contraceptive benefits of COCs, most of which I've already mentioned. So endometriosis is where there is endometrial tissue in abnormal locations outside of the endometrium. And with natural cyclical estrogen, this will cause proliferation and degeneration of abnormal endometrial tissue the way it does normal endometrial tissue. And this causes a lot of pain and discomfort. So the pill just levels this out and inhibits that cyclical proliferation and degeneration. It also reduces the risk of pelvic inflammatory disease, which is related to the cervical mucus thickening, blocking pathogens from going up into the uterus. Ectopic pregnancy is a major cause of death in developing countries, so prevention of this is also very significant. So I'm just going to finish with this endnote that for now, there is no one perfect contraceptive formulation or even method that has no side effects or that is like 100% effective. In addition, each person will have their own health risk profile, which would influence which option would be better for you. Please note, I have not gone over other forms of contraception, such as the intrauterine devices or non-hormonal methods, so please go ahead and research into these further on your own. And finally, I just wanted to say that this video is intended for educational purposes only and not medical advice. This is a video essay on the steroid hormone receptor activity of progestins and the evolution of oral contraceptives. Thank you for watching.